بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم brothers and sisters and welcome to Ramadan nights on the third night of Ramadan 1441 after the blessed hijrah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I am your host Abu Abdurrahman, and that was Omar playing with the mic, ruling the introduction. Barakallahu feek, Ustaz Omar, Dr. Omar. Assalamu alaikum to our dear brothers, our host, co-host, Dr. Omar Najarin. And Sheikh Nasim Abadi, assalamu alaikum, brothers.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi.
Omar, you seem like out of it, fully in sync.
I was just reading the topic for today, so I'll get you to explain.
Alhamdulillah, that. Great preparation.
So you just read the topic right now?
Nah, because you confused me, because it's not what he said.
What do you mean?
He said what not to do in Ramadan. That's not the topic.
It's along the lines.
It's not even close.
What not to do in restriction, the lockdown.
Yeah, what not to do under restrictions in Ramadan.
So was there a typo or something? We apologize for the typo.
No, it's no typo. It's just saying that we've got to relate.
The topic
it to
will be what not to do under restrictions in Ramadan.
We could have had this conversation off air.
Could have been like during the team prep.
You could have sent a message.
No, no, it's because we always talk about what not to do in Ramadan, right? Like, for example, don't go to the clubs, don't go to the pubs, don't go
that's
to these.
That's at all times.
Now it's sort of completely shifted, and it's what not to do within the four walls of your house.
Yeah.
Which is interesting because we've never really got into that.
Correct. Like that was actually the whole point. So we know, alhamdulillah, a lot of people, they know and they've heard the general subject of what not to do in Ramadan. So this one is actually differently because obviously our circumstances are different. So what not to do inside or underneath the restrictions because of all the things that we're seeing from problems inside the houses and the cases coming out and the issues that are happening in the household.
You know what we've just done? We've just shown not like what not to do when starting a program. What do you think about that one, Dr. Omar?
Whether in or under, in or out of restrictions.
You know what? It's important, and it's actually a very good topic too that we touch on, because what not to do also, as we know, the letterhead is under the New South Wales government /police/whatever. It was actually quite of a surprise that they actually wrote a statement directing it to Ramadan, iftar, and visiting others.
Of course. I have a slight feeling, and I'm a conspiracy theory man, but this one's not necessarily a conspiracy theory, but it's my thought, that part of the reason they're now prolonging the restrictions and the lockdowns is because of Ramadan.
What do you think about that, Dr. Omar?
Think about it. Let me explain for 1 second before you get into it. Just let's think about it for 1 second. If you have, every single masjid, mashallah, is going to be full. If you have 300, 400, 500 people congregating in one place and they don't want it to spread, they know that these 300, 400, 500 Muslims are active members of the community. So they're going to go to the masjid, then go to work, then go to their families, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So if they loosen it now, they start to remove some of these restrictions now, if they're worried about it spreading, if they are, then you don't want them congregating 300, 400 people in the masjid at a time.
I think also because we're not really in a, as they say, safe zone at the moment. And they, like Singapore, released restrictions and they had another outbreak, and they reinstated their restrictions again. So I think, because once you lift them, it's actually going to be a big effort to lift them, and they put them back on, and it's even more than that. But it's just out of interest, because they take notice. See, it's like a shahada for the believer that they take notice that Ramadan is a time that families come together. And it's like, be jealous of us. Look.
They do have their advisors as well. They do have their Muslim advisors and community relations.
Because they realize that Ramadan is a time that we visit one another and we spend time with one another. And that to me is subhanAllah, something special. That as believers, we're known to the non-believers of people to be very family orientated, especially when it comes to the month of Ramadan.
Dear brothers, we haven't even welcomed our listeners and our viewers on Facebook. Welcome to all our viewers on Facebook. Please share the feed if you're watching on Facebook. Share far and wide and share in the reward. And we do have...
That's good. If you can't share your iftar feed, you can share your Facebook feed.
Yes. You're sharing some food.
Huh?
Now, before we get into the topic, Dr. Omar.
Before that, he done a little bit of a welcome. And I feel a bit left out. Like he just, you know, done a little bit of a, you know, I don't know what you want to call that. Like a salute or al-Rossi or whatever. I don't know, man. What do I do?
I don't know.
Just wave.
You're a bit unique. I don't know. Do what you like. I don't know.
Thumbs up.
Yeah, thumbs up. Yeah.
You got
one of these ones. Whatever you want to do.
Sheikh Jalal is gonna kill us again.
Why is that?
What's that?
Sheikh Jalal thinks that me and Omar should not be on the radio together.
What's that salute? They anyway, Allah, move on. They will live.
We've already got some messages.
You
don't want to know from who. We'll mention him later. Anyway, welcome all our viewers and listeners. We do listening on the Wi-Fi radios and on our apps. We have some Wi-Fi radios to give away tonight. We'll start off with one. So we will mention a question from what we are discussing. Basically answer it. First one to answer it on Facebook will win a free Wi-Fi radio. Inshallah, we'll send it out to them free of charge if they're in Sydney, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. We're mentioning in Sydney because someone won it the other day in North Queensland.
MashaAllah. In North Queensland?
Yes. So,
alhamdulillah.
We have to download the app. Mail that to him. Yeah, but some people like having the Wi-Fi radio at home, especially the sisters.
Actually, you know what? Someone was talking about this. We'll mention the Wi-Fi radios. And someone said, you know, why would I buy the radio when I can just use the app? Is subhanAllah, so much difference. In reality, how much are you going to open up the app during the day? In reality. If you're on WhatsApp or if you're on Facebook or if you're on a phone call, you're not going to be listening to the app. But when you have the radio there, it's beautiful because you can just leave it in the background.
Some people have it in the kitchen. It's just on all the time.
In the last week, we've advertised free delivery. And every single day, we're getting a lot of deliveries. And 95% of them are sisters. Yeah. So wanting the radio for those who don't have it. And they prefer to have the Wi-Fi radio. It's loud. You can put it anywhere you like. It connects from anywhere in the home if they have Wi-Fi. And it's durable, it's quite good. So online you can find out how. Whoever would like one can message us and send us their address and the campaign online. So, and we will deliver it as soon as possible.
I actually need to take two today, inshallah.
Inshallah, barakallah feekum. Now let's get into this topic. What not to do in Ramadan, especially when we're under restrictions. Where do you start, Sheikh Nasim?
طيب بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على آله وصحبه ومن والاه أما بعد. I think we can start with divorce.
Don't get divorced in Ramadan.
In Ramadan. We alluded to it a couple of weeks ago.
Don't get divorced in any month, not only Ramadan.
We said a couple of weeks ago that the pressures are going to be increased. Being in the face of the spouse the whole day and the children being at home and some people, their financial situation is not the best. So a lot of people, they're going to go through a lot more pressure, a lot more hardship. And that a lot of the time is released on one spouse to the other spouse because that's their rock, that's their support. So they usually express themselves in a way that they wouldn't necessarily express with someone else. Because they know that there's more compassion between the partners, etc. And sometimes, unfortunately, that leads all the way to divorce, which is what we don't want. Sharia has made divorce halal, but that doesn't necessarily mean that we should take advantage of it like you take advantage of drinking water, which is halal. Divorce is a means of leading to that which is better. So if there's a couple and their life together is not fruitful, it's causing problems, it's causing people to commit haram, etc., 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 then you would get divorced in order to live a better Islamic lifestyle.
Now, are we discussing it from which angle now? Because the people are fasting, divorce may be higher, or because of the restrictions people on each other's faces?
The restrictions. Okay. Alhamdulillah, fasting, some people get a bit angry, but yeah, and it's usually dealt with easily. But because there's no release, there's no, okay, I'm going to work, I'll see you like for 1 hour in the afternoon. There's none of that. There's no, all right, I'm going to go to my friend's house and relax for an hour. There's none of that. There's no, the kids are going to go, you know, for 2 hours to their cousin's house and, I'll relax for two. There's none of that. It's just pressure upon pressure upon pressure.
You know, I've noticed something today and over the last week or two, I've never seen so many people going for walks as I have seen recently just in the local area where I live.
Yeah, this
Have you noticed that, Dr. Omar?
That's the only, a few things that a person can do. And one of them is to leave the house. He's allowed to exercise.
So Bunnings is always full.
Part of that is releasing that stress. It's part of it. Part of releasing that stress, changing the job, changing the environment, that you're not just seeing yourself in four walls the whole day. Very important. Very important, because a lot of brothers, unfortunately, and I had a case, obviously I'm not going to mention the name, so it's not backbiting or it's not exposing, because no one knows. I had a brother the other day, and like I said before, I don't even do with marriage and divorce, but he had problems with his wife. She asked for khula. She was given khula, and now they're talking, okay, after she finishes her iddah, can we redo the katab kitab? So it's like, obviously the problems aren't that enormous for you to even contemplate after a divorce, right after the iddah, to redo your katab kitab again. It's sad, but this is an example. It's a manifestation of the build up of pressure that's happening in the
Inshallah,
house.
We are going to have a program about divorce and khula, and when can khula be done and not, because a lot of people are asking these questions because some may feel that it's been given too easy.
It's been given very easy. Mm-hmm. This is part of the issue. Mm-hmm. Like some brothers, I'll give a funny story. For the brothers, Allah Azza wa Jal put the divorce in your hands because you're not as emotional. So it's not as though every click of the finger, you're meant to say to your wife, khalas, you're divorced. Now, unfortunately, we're seeing that. Now we're seeing that more and more. There are a lot of brothers, they're not taking the responsibility. They're breaking very easy under pressure. They're saying, this is not what I signed up for. They've been watching too many movies and listening to too many songs, thinking that their life is going to be fairy tales and bunny rabbits and rose petals their entire life. La, Habib, it doesn't work like that. Believe me.
Bunny rabbits, huh?
Bunny rabbits. Naam. So divorces are happening a lot. Naam. And a lot of
isn't it doves?
There's a lot of
isn't it doves? Yeah. Bunny rabbits.
I didn't want to say nothing, but he said,
both trying not to laugh. Yani, khalas, move on.
Khalas, we know what you mean. Moving on.
Let's see him say that. He like, I hope no one noticed.
No, I always say bunny rabbits and balloons and
rose
petals, but
I
didn't say balloons.
Move on.
Okay, so don't have a false pretense or false imagination of what marriage really is from the entertainment
world. And so when you go through problems, don't think, okay, the first thing I'm going to go to is divorce. La, this is not how Muslim is. And subhanAllah, my father-in-law, rahmatullah alayhi, when I was a very rare man, mashallah, my father-in-law, rahmatullah alayhi, when I was engaged to my wife, it was obviously, inshallah, we're going towards marriage. My father-in-law, rahmatullah alayhi, he sent me down and he said, look, Nasim, you cannot, you're going to get through a lot of problems in marriage. You cannot think of divorce. You cannot think of divorce, meaning, and he explained, he goes, you can't, the first thing that comes to your mind when you get through a problem, khalas, I don't want to deal with this problem, you're divorced. He goes, you cannot think like that. He goes, just withhold it. He goes, withhold it. Even for the mut'akhar, the Lebanese, our tradition is that, the mut'adam and the mut'akhar. From the mut'akhar, he wanted to put like $1, like nothing. He said, like, this is his mentality. He goes, Ami, if it leads to that, he goes, if my daughter is bad, then she doesn't deserve more than $1. And if you're bad, then we don't want $1 from you. That's what divorce is. That, it's reached to a level where it's best for everyone that you're separated, especially for your deen. So if it's not at that level, don't be emotional, don't be quick, don't be hasty and say, wallah, divorced. The man gets emotional, the woman gets emotional. We shouldn't react in a bad way. The same time, a lot of women, they get emotional, and a lot of sisters, they're frustrated in these times. Again, as we said, the husband's always there, the kids are always there. They're not able to do things that normally they would do to relax, etc. And so sometimes in the woman, in her frustration, she might say the words, divorce me. She might say that. She might get angry and frustrated and upset, and she might say just as words, divorce me. Yani, as a brother, don't say, wallah, all right, divorce. Don't do that. She's saying because she's emotional. After she calms down, give them, sometimes it's wallah, sometimes it's 5 minutes.
I think we just need patience.
Yeah,
it is a month of patience.
Just relax, and inshallah, in a couple of hours or in the next day, sometimes even in the next 5 minutes, all of it's going to be fine again.
Let's move on to the next one. We've discussed.
Don't get divorced.
Is there more? Don't get divorced.
Dr. Omar. I'll tell you the funny story, but.
Tfaddal.
Because I said I'll give you a funny story.
I like how he said the I don't deal with divorces or whatever, just to make a note that no one call me,
no one message me, no one talks to me on Facebook.
what not to do during restrictions in the month of Ramadan? I find one of the key things is don't become less energetic that you should be in the month of Ramadan, and don't become lazy. So what we find is people, they're at home, so to pass time or waste time, they're lying down on the couch, they fall asleep. That, you know, we always say people, they go out, they turn their nights into days and their days into nights, but people can do that at home too, where they're turning, you know, the day and night into night. Yani they're sleeping 24/7, or, you know, they can't handle the children, or they can't handle the wife. There's bickering, there's arguing, and there's whatever. Now, look at it like, this is nothing compared to being in a wartime where, you know, you're not just being at home and forced to be at home. You know, you have to deal with, as being the man of the house, you have to deal with the responsibilities of the household. And so likewise, now you're in like a minor wartime where you now have to take on responsibility. Now, if you're going to be punching on with your wife every day, and it's not going to benefit you, you're a man of the house. If you're going to be lazy, what are the kids going to do? You're going to be lying down all day. The kids are going to be lying down all day. Wife is going to be lying in. There's no proactive thing happening inside the house. Take so, leadership. For example, exercise. Going for walks, as Khun and Adal mentioned, you know, doing activities with the kids, it could be painting, Play-Doh, whatever, something that interests them. I know a brother went and got all these little timbers from Bunnings and stuff like that, and told his kids, all right, let's say, you know, he made his kids into teams, and the girls and the guys, whatever, and they had to build something out of the timber. For example, it took them the whole day and paint it or whatever.
I have an idea who that is.
It was like
Are
you serious?
Someone.
But
that's a joke. I'm just
giving an example, like, you know, make a mailbox, whatever it is. But the kids, they get into it. It gets them active. It gets them moving. It gets the parents moving too. So laziness in the month of Ramadan, especially in restrictions, sometimes you're forced to become lazy, but you have to fight yourself. You have to get up and you have to do things. Now, if you look at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, I think we fail to understand it wasn't home masjid. It wasn't like that. You know, it was waking up in the morning, you know, going, checking the livestock, you know, preparing food for them. You know, the camels have to eat, and the sheep have to eat, and the donkeys have to eat. Going, and they report that some of the female companions would climb to, some of the zara, the planting of herbs and whatever, used to be up high on mountains. So they would climb up there, and they would pick the herbs, they'll pick whatever they need, and they'll come back down. Some of them will travel far distances for food and so forth. Yani they had a proactive and life, and within that was Islam. You know, we always hear stories of, you know, like, for example, the companions, how, you know, some of them, they used to work, they used to split their time, they used to sit with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and so forth. So you look at the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, there were times where, you know, there was preparation of food. There was a lot of things happening. It wasn't just, you know, you don't expect people to read Quran from the time they wake up to the time they go to sleep. There must be ibadah. There must be, yes, recitation of the Quran. There must be salah. Salah and jama'ah. How many people are so lazy that the mum prays at a certain time, the dad prays at a certain time, the kids pray, one prays here, one prays there, one prays two rakat, one prays one rakat, one prays without wudu. It's just a mess. No structure in the house. So laziness, especially for those that are not working, they're at home because, you know, maybe, you know, restrictions at work or whatever, or they're working from home. Don't let the laziness of the household destroy your month of Ramadan, because even you're in restriction or isolation or whatever it may be, it doesn't change what Ramadan is. It doesn't change Laylatul Qadr. It doesn't change the mercy of Allah. It doesn't change the reward that Allah gives a person. It doesn't change forgiveness. It doesn't change anything. If anything, if you're at home, you're actually less exposed to fitna.
JazakAllah khair, Dr. Omar. We got a few messages. I don't want it to pile up, so I'll read some of them. Some of our brothers and sisters gave salam. Wa alaykum as-salam. JazakAllah khair wa iyakum. Sheikh Jameer sends a message. MashaAllah, Sheikh Naseem and Dr. Omar, always a pleasure to watch. My salam to the both of you. Wa alaykum as-salam. Also, I think we got some messages from Wollongong. Awatif Sawan. JazakAllah khair, Sheikhana. I think he's talking to Sheikh from Wollongong over here, Sheikh Naseem. We miss Masjid as-salam a lot.
Ay wallah, subhanAllah. SubhanAllah, yani, when before coronavirus, everyone's planning for the month of Ramadan. Allah, everyone's planning for the month of Ramadan. And in the back of my, you know, the shura, we had countless meetings on Ramadan and how much we're going to read in Ramadan and the da'wah plan in Ramadan and bringing mashayikh from overseas in Ramadan. And then SubhanAllah, now when you are hoping to see all of the community in Ramadan, SubhanAllah, it's not there. But wallahi, it's a massive restart button for us, and inshallah Azza wa Jal, after coronavirus, I'm sure the messages are going to be full.
You have to like a 100 meter race, Dr. Omar.
Exactly, before earthing.
what is earthing? Can you explain to us what is earthing? Now, for those who don't know, Dr. Omar is a podiatrist. He's not a backyard doctor. What is earthing?
We mentioned earthing. We discussed a long time ago. Allah alam. I can't really comment about evidence or whatever. But it was a theory that, you know, as you walk, the energy of the earth goes in your body and feet or whatever it may be. But putting that aside, from the scientific perspective, medical perspective, and the advice of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu to walk barefoot, and the companions they used to, is because we ask a simple question. Your body is created, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in a certain way, and that certain way is for the body to adapt to the earth. That's very important, because your body is not created for earth. Your body, Adam alayhi salam, was created for paradise. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the human body that he's able to adapt himself to earth, where we are today. Because as we know, Adam alayhi salam came down from the heavens to earth. In saying that, when your body adapts to something, that's what's normally beneficial. And your body knows how to work through that. And that's the best for your body. So walking barefoot, natural terrain, grass, sand, whatever, yes, it uses muscles that you haven't used. That's why your feet get very sore the next day. It's actually better for the body, better for, you know, the muscles, better for a lot of things. But what do we do? We implement, for example, concrete tiles everywhere. And this actually causes a lot of problems for people. So as we said, when you want to run or run a walk, it is advised, and we see that elite athletes, where they run. We always see, you know, videos of them running where? Either on the beach, barefoot, or on grass. They incorporate that in their training. Why? Because that's actually very good for the body and very good for the muscles and overall physical activity.
Inshallah, keep that in mind.
Inshallah, every once in a while we'll ask Dr. Omar a question about that. Because there's a lot of misconceptions regarding that as well. But before we do continue, Sheikh Naseem, our question to win the free Wi-Fi radio is, name the two things we mentioned not to do during Ramadan, especially during the restrictions. So far we've mentioned two things. Sheikh Naseem mentioned one. Dr. Omar mentioned one. Just answer it in the comment section. First one to answer correctly will win a free Wi-Fi radio, which inshallah will mail out to you if you are in Sydney.
I've got one more restriction. Just popped in before I forget it.
So we're going to make it three?
What not to do? Make it three.
Make it three. Fadal. What's the Don't third rely- one?
This is actually honest. It's not really a joke. Don't rely on Uber Eats and all these things. No, it's actually true. Reason being is because, yani, being in the home and having food cooked in the home is a barakah, without a doubt. Like without a doubt.
I actually found that a lot of people have actually cut down on Uber Eats.
Some people are leaving breakfast, lunch, and dinner on Uber Eats.
Well, who's having lunch now?
I'm saying, yani, even now it's
2 days. Two days.
Do they run at iftar at suhoor? But what I'm saying is, don't rely on these type of things. Yani, use this to. Some people have never turned the stove on at home.
This is actually part of the good points of coronavirus, and there's a lot of good to come out. You know, the believers' affairs, all of them are good. Part of the good that I found is actually, subhanAllah, so many more people, married couples, newly married, yeah, the older married couples, usually they're very good at cooking anyway, mashallah, but a lot of, especially the younger generation, they're actually, mashallah, getting their hands dirty with the cooking at home.
Give it a go. And if anyone wants to post anything of a Facebook page of failing, failed cooking, go ahead. So you burnt something, you burnt the lasagna, or the cake fell apart, or whatever.
I'm not going to lie to you. If I had the time, I'd love to get in the kitchen.
It's actually beautiful. And
I don't have the time.
And advice,
I love getting in the kitchen.
Advice for the parents, get the children involved in, not obviously cooking the meal, but some aspect of the cooking. You know what I mean? Like, make sure some people have daughters that are 14, 15 years old. They've never cut a tomato in their life.
You know, there is some...
Get them involved, man. Cut the tomato.
It's another issue.
Give them, not a sharp knife, give them a knife. Cut the tomato.
14
cut the
years old. She can have a sharp knife 14 years old.
Shala, we have a course in the pipeline. Is how to prepare teenage kids for marriage.
Oh, excellent.
All right. And it was actually requested by parents. I'm not going to mention which school. And I'm not going to mention the sheikh yet, because it's in the pipeline. It's in the works. Because a lot of parents came up to the teachers and said, especially the sheikhs that work at these schools, they said, my kids are leaving, like they're 18, 19, 20, and this is both male and female, so not to select one without the other, or aim at one without the other, and they're not really ready. And the parents have a role, but the community does as well. The school being a large factor, because they're at school, you know, for 40 weeks a year.
In the olden days, yeah, a lot of our grandparents, especially their parents, that generation, they was that yani 15 years old is like average for marriage.
And just want to know,
I think changed quite a bit.
Your grandmother, who was it? I think it was you. Your grandmother.
Can we mention off air, not on air?
Oh, okay.
No.
Mute.
Mashallah, she was young.
No, from my family, yes, yeah. They got married at 12.
Back in those days,
it was completely normal. It was yani completely normal. Because from a young age, they knew. The young age, they knew, mashallah.
14, 15.
How to do everything in the
different,
house.
Different times.
Sheikh Nasim, the thing is, people don't realize cooking is a profession. You know what I mean? Like, you know, building is a profession. You build something, you see it. Cooking is a profession. It's actually chefs, and it's a multi-billion dollar industry. Yani, you being a cook and making something is something special. And it's something to, and when if I build the chair, you're going to say, wow, that's a hectic job you did. But if I make your tabkha, you're just going to eat it and not really look into it. But if you really understand that our mums, what they did from beginning to end.
I disagree. I can tell when my wife has made a tabkha, when Albert, I can tell.
What's a tabkha again? For those who don't know.
Like she's made a dish. From her heart.
Allah, I didn't bring your wife. I brought your mum into it.
No, I'm.
Because mums don't fault, brother.
No,
mums don't fault in the cooking. That's what.
Even my mother now, I can tell when my mother or my wife or anyone.
Don't step there. Don't go there. Don't go there, guys.
Cooks with their heart, you can tell you. And even like this part of the laziness that you're talking about. Yeah, don't be lazy, huh? We're gonna put one, your point number two and point number three together. That don't be lazy and cook, use this time to cook. When they cook from their heart, you can actually taste their heart.
What I'm saying is that a meal, it's art, it's effort. Yani some of the meals that they take, I'm not talking every single meal. I'm not talking about your 2 minute noodles or whatever. I'm talking about every single meal that the heart is put into it. You see how special it is. Like the other day, right? Yani my mom was doing lubia, okay. And I thought to myself, like, every lubia, she cracked it with her own hands. Yeah, that type of thought.
Or green beans? What are
the green beans, yeah. Every single one, she did it by hand. Yeah, there's not one of them I'm eating that hasn't been broken. You know what I mean? And it's a lot of effort into it. So what I'm trying to say is, that side of it, when a person is cooking, or his wife is cooking, or whatever, what not to do is just order takeaway, because you lose the blessing.
It's good you bring it back,
because I was thinking we're
hearing a cooking show here. What's going on? Maybe next Saturday we'll have
why not?
Dr. Omar's top 5 cooking tips. What do you think? Let's continue. But before we do, whoever would like to win a free Wi-Fi radio, answer the question that we mentioned before. Name the two things, or three things now. Two is enough. That we mentioned what not to do at the beginning of the program. Two things not to do during Ramadan, especially in restrictions. Answer on our Facebook page, and the first one to answer correctly will win a Wi-Fi radio. If someone would like to call in, doesn't have Facebook, call in 9740-6160.
You know, the thing is that if you get pulled over for no reason, like normally most people say, I'm getting something to eat, I'm going to get food. Possibly most of the cops and that now know that you're fasting. You're not going to get away with that. Explain
to him the
My name is Muhammad Abdullah. Are you fasting?
Explain to him that females at certain times in the month they don't fast. So you're getting it for your wife.
You give you a full fiqh lesson to the guys.
We've got two answers that both came in at the same time. One's in Melbourne, one's in Sydney. They both answered right. Not get divorced and not be lazy.
Khala, Sydney.
Okay. Ghazi Ali and Abu Sumaya. They'll both get one, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Both get one. We'll contact you after the program. Bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. Barakallahu feekum. So the two things not to do is don't divorce in Ramadan and don't get lazy.
Can I announce the fourth one, but he has to talk about it?
Tafadda, Dr. Omar.
Oh, no.
Do not waste your time. We say basically, but this is in particular, making stupid TikTok videos.
Firstly, what is TikTok? Many of us may not know what TikTok is.
Yalla, tafadda.
Is it short videos?
I chucked it to Sheikh Nasim now. He has to.
Short videos? What is it?
I, alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, I don't have TikTok. I don't have the app for TikTok.
Neither do I.
I don't know anyone that does personally TikTok videos that I know of. Naam. But I know that it exists and I know that it's a bigger problem in the community. From what I've been told and what I see, because I see something on my Facebook feed that pops up, the TikTok videos, it's just an app full of music and stupid videos. Whatever the new trend is or fad is, boom, they're jumping onto it. The non-Muslims doing it is one thing, but unfortunately, and these are from the millions of people that I've spoken to, that have messaged me or spoken to me about it, is that the Muslims doing it. Especially sisters in hijab.
And that's because they're home, they're restricted.
No. Even before.
But now it's more.
Now it's probably worse.
That's what we want to stay within the restrictions.
Now it's probably worse with the brothers. From what I've been told, now it's worse with the brothers because a lot of the brothers jumped on board and they're making the videos. The sisters that were doing it before, Now, a lot of the mothers, they're not going to make these silly videos, I hope.
So now, all these social media, if you don't use it properly, don't use it.
I'm just thinking about it, subhanAllah. I've seen one, it was a Muslim couple. The husband, the wife, and kids. And I'm just thinking to myself, one, you've got your wife dancing. That's one. In a hijab, she's in a hijab. One, you got your wife dancing. Two, you're putting your kids out there with the extreme potential for them to cop the ayn. Three, imagine on top of your wife being inappropriately out there, your children possibly being exposed to the ayn, imagine that every single person that sees that video is now going to get sins and you're going to get their sins. Imagine. And those things spread like wildfire. You can't control who now is going to see that, who's not going to see that. It's out there. It could be 1,000 people, it could be 10,000 people, 100,000 people, it could be 1,000,000 people that get that sin. You're going to, in that one day, get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5,000 sins, and that can continue until the day of judgment, potentially.
And you got to understand that who are the ones that promote, like, where does it come from? From people of khair and goodness, or came from shayateen?
We need to be really, really, really above this. Like, this is, we can't stoop to this level of lowness. Yeah. We need to be people who are much better than this. Between you and your family to muck around, to say jokes, and us as brothers, that's one thing. But then to go put yourself out there because everyone else is doing it, that's something you can never take back off the internet. For you to go and to put yourself dancing like a goose or like a monkey, to put your wife out there, wallahi, it's embarrassing. Especially the sisters, without hijab, you may want to repent one day, inshallah, azza wa jal, by putting hijab, etc. But khalas, that sin could continue on going.
I just want to add that the privacy and all that stuff where you click agree, 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 and don't read nothing. That stuff for Facebook, whatever. Anyway, what it mentions in there is that any photos that you post to Facebook, Instagram, and I assume TikTok too, and whatever, becomes the property of
that company.
So if you post up a Facebook or whatever, they now own that picture. And even if you delete it or whatever, it can always resurface. It's always there. Nothing. If you got to understand, nothing ever really gets deleted. That's why a lot of people don't understand why. There's been court cases. Look into it. People will research. There have been court cases where people have deleted text messages. and I've deleted photos, and then a forensic data analyst, they call him or whatever, goes to the phone and gets all the information out. How did he do that? Because if people understand how computers work, nothing really gets deleted. The only thing that happens is when you delete something, it has to be replaced with something else. And that normally takes a long period of time before it does that. But pretty much, even if you delete these things, they still exist. And how do you know no one has downloaded those videos?
Not only that, from your phone, when you use these apps, it's not just on your phone now. It's on the app. The app owns it. That TikTok or that Facebook or that Snapchat, they own it. So even if it's deleted from your phone, which most of the apps do get deleted, it's not yours anymore either way. It's stored with them in their own cloud.
There's a world out there that we, you know, I remember a brother, he said to me, he goes, really, you know what? I realized that I lived in a bubble until I started, he went on a business trip and started, he goes, until I really started to see the world, I realized I lived in a bubble thinking everyone fears Allah and everyone wants good and khair. He goes, we live in an evil, evil world. I remember when we went to Al-Madinah, there was Sheikh Jalal, may Allah reward him, took us to some brothers that were part of sort of like a police force that would investigate and go after sorcerers and magicians. That was their job. And I remember asking one of the workers there, I go, this is Al-Madinah, this is Medina. Why do you need a department that goes after sorcerers and that? He goes to me, because it's very prominent. Yani even in the blessed land, there was the sorcerers and magicians. Yani when it's like magician, we're talking about black magic, not Allah make something disappear. We're not talking about the illusionists, we're talking about magicians. So even in Al Medina, it existed, which is supposed to be the land of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they find them and they either deport them or whatever they do, the had or whatever they do upon them. But if that exists there, then these photos, you hear about black magic, what do they always say? Give me a photo of the person. They've got the photo of the person. They've got the date of birth. How do they got the date of birth? How would they have the date of birth? Because people take a photo of their child. Happy birthday, so and so. Oh, it's my son's birthday today in front of a birthday cake. So someone has got a hand. Someone in the alia that has got jealous towards you. He's got a photo of your son and he's got his birthday. And he's got his mother's name. They're the three things that any sorcerer or magician will ask. Give me these three things and I will put magic on a person. And it exists and it's true. So what have you done? You've exposed your family to evil. Even though you're thinking, I'm innocent, you know, everyone wants khair. No, no, no. Yes, some people want khair. But Allah Ta'ala and more people have jealousy and envy towards you, especially if you make your whole life.
You don't know who's looking at you. You don't know who's looking at you.
I don't understand. The brothers are hugging their wife and the full selfie, and he's doing pash lips and she's doing. What are you doing, brother? This is you and your wife. The fear Allah. It is not a private, this is a public platform. What's wrong with you? Is there something wrong with you?
And they usually divorce after 3 weeks.
and you know what? Why. And you hear that. But why? What happened? It's because your own hands, what you've done. So what not to do in Ramadan and in restrictions, don't display your whole life on the internet, on Facebook. Some people are, oh yeah, today we're waking up and this is the day number 20 of the restrictions.
He made me strawberry for school.
Look, this is, you know, this is my son. He hasn't made his bed yet. And this is little Aisha. Look, she's playing with her dolls. Who cares? That's your life. It's your personal life.
I'm going to put it out there, Dr. Omar. Do you feel sometimes, and Sheikh Nasim, do you feel sometimes where, you know, many of us are living our lives like just a movie, you know, action. Let's take a selfie. Everyone act happy. And then after,
I'm lucky.
Everyone's in their own corner.
I think actually all three of us, I think we're part of the lucky ones that aren't really on social media, in the sense that we follow people. We have it for dawah reasons, you got for your business, but we don't have it where we follow, you know, people. Imagine having like 300-400 people on your friend list, or you're following 300-400 people on Instagram. Imagine the crap that you would see and go through. And that kind of lifestyle that you live, that you're always in competition with everyone else just to try and show, oh, look at the shoes I bought. Look at the shirt that I bought.
Imagine someone just losing his son. His son just died, right? 3-4 years old, he died. He's watching a video of you putting your son, saying, oh, look, he's taking his first steps. If he's a man, he's going to say, why am I, how come he, you know, he's going to start building hatred. And you think about it. And this is why I said not everyone wants khair. If anything, I guarantee you, when you stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment, you would know, because they'll be exposed to you. The ones that will give you the ayn is not the neighbor, it's not the, it's the ones with your own family.
Your own circle,
your own brother, sister, sister-in-law, brother-in-law, grandma, grandfather, auntie, uncle, niece, nephew, one of those. They're the ones spitting the ayn. And subhanAllah, a lot of people would say, and it happened a lot, tragedy would strike them on the day of Eid. You hear that? Got in an accident, his son fell over and broke his leg or whatever. Why? They dress up the kids so nicely, so beautiful. You know, they put so much wealth, so much everything in their kids. Photos, oh look at my kids, Eid, this and that, whatever, and all the presents. And then the ayn starts. Oh my God, their kids are dressed better than me. Oh, whatever, whatever, whatever. SubhanAllah, tragedy strikes on the day of Eid.
And just to clarify, when Dr. Amr is saying these and we're discussing this point, it doesn't mean don't show any goodness or don't show any of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, and as for the blessings of your Lord, then preach and talk about it. But this is not just talking, this is not just to everyone. I don't go to everyone and say, oh, alhamdulillah, I bought this today and I'll talk about today.
I think it's more to do with
don't rub it in people's face.
I think it's more to do with extreme public display of all this stuff.
This is just for you to talk about your family members, alhamdulillah, my wife's pregnant, masalan, or alhamdulillah, brothers, I had a daughter or a son come to my walima. This is no problem. And make sure you take the asbab, like doing the adhkar on yourself and reading Quran on your family and doing the Quran recitation, etc., on your household. All of this is extremely important for that protection to come. But don't put yourself out there unnecessarily. When you talk about social media, you don't have control over that anymore. You put it out there, someone screenshots it. Your friends, your so-called friends, the people randomly that see you on the social media platforms. You don't know who's looking. You don't know what their intentions are. You don't know anything about
especially
that.
Especially if Allah's blessed you, that you don't show that you're poor and you show the blessing. But like I said, you don't rub it in people's faces, especially on those that don't need to see it. They have no connection in your life, whatever, even if it's a distant relative. Like, for example, photo of your family, everything, that's fine. Your mom, your dad, okay. You send them a message, look, mom, look, dad, they're the people, never going to have a girl. But to let it out there and say, happiest family in the world. And the lady that's looking at it just got
divorced.
divorced, or her husband refused to give her money to buy clothes for her kids on Eid, or whatever it may be. She's looking at it. Do you know the way they look at it? They look at it like, when you look at a holiday destination, you got the beach and the sand, the nice sun and this and that and everything. And it's just a vision. But when you're there, it's hot, it's stinky, there's mosquitoes. You know what I mean? There's probably wild animals everywhere. And reality kicks in.
Where'd you go?
The reality kicks in. That's the truth. That's when someone looks at paradise, but really behind it is something else.
You know what I cannot understand. I know maybe you can help me out. I don't know why we need to show others why we love our wives or husbands or our kids. Why don't we just show our wives, show our husbands, show our kids that we love them? Why do we have to show the whole world?
Because we're empty inside and we need validation. Simple as that.
Barakallah.
We need someone to say, oh, mashallah, how beautiful. Oh, mashallah, so sweet. Oh, mashallah, I wish. Oh, mashallah, I can't wait. Who wants that? You know how many...
They look at the likes. How many likes?
Not just how many sisters promoted their husbands. My husband does this. My husband does that. My husband does this. And then talk about the jealousy, because we came across a lot of cases like this. Unfortunately, a lot of her friends or her family members would actually try and take the husband away from her.
Yeah.
Because you're putting it out there that like
day 40 of my husband going to the gym.
Yeah, you made this perfect husband. Of course they're gonna try and get it.
What do they call them? Those singlets? Is it they're going like that?
Tank tops,
like, alhamdulillah, my husband looking good.
That's the easy side, but I'm talking about
what are you doing?
My husband made me this, and my husband made me that, and my husband's so sweet, he bought me this, and my husband's so amazing.
Takes a picture of flowers, look what I just got.
Let's move on.
Part on that, but it's like a separate. It's like a.
One point.
We're like 4.5.
Regarding the ayin and sihr, this all happens by the will and permission of Allah. Nothing is out of the approval and permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has allowed these things to happen as a test of life, like other things. And maybe we can talk about this more in detail in future.
But He's
lessons.
Told us how to protect ourselves.
That's
from
right. Allah has given us the way to protect ourselves, but He is in total control. Nothing is out of the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tafadhal, Sheikh.
On the one, so there's the ones that do it, but then there are also the ones that share it. Okay, so you may be a person who doesn't have TikTok yourself, alhamdulillah, or you don't have these, you don't make these silly videos, but if it comes to you, don't share it. On some of the more broader WhatsApp groups that we have, like family and stuff. So sometimes a person, maybe they're not as on the deen or they're whatever. So they send videos and wallahi, it's like pretty bad, man. Yani girls in, I don't know what you call it.
Say girls just inappropriately.
Inappropriately. That's it.
Guys as well, yeah.
Girls just inappropriately. And, yeah, ammi. All right, she gets the sin. That's one thing. But then you're showing her, you also get the haram. What's the benefit out of sharing it?
So what not to do in restrictions in Ramadan is don't spread haram.
Don't spread 100%.
Yani, I think, like, in a way, the people, they're bored at home. They think, social media, this and that, whatever. Yeah, it could be used like, you're FaceTiming your grandparents, this, that, whatever, keeping connection, keeping in line of silat al-raham and things like that. They're the positive things. They're the good things. Reminding people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a new update about, the coronavirus, and updates are you're sharing them around. That's fine. Some people have put entertainment videos. They're not haram. It could be funny, you share it for a little bit of light entertainment.
Could be scared, whatever.
That's all right. But, when you're getting into things that are displaying haram and things like that. A brother once told me a story. He said people used to send him a lot of stuff on WhatsApp. And some of them are very bad stuff. Anyway, I'm not sure exactly how it works in regards to media, but sometimes the things get stored on the phone.
Yeah, you gotta turn off the setting so it doesn't store.
So his son, 5, 6, 7 years old, around like that age, or his son's around that age, they grab the phone, they're playing with it, and they go, they want to check the gallery, see their photos they just took the day before. And they went into the WhatsApp gallery where the WhatsApp videos were all stored, and they saw the thing. Now, he didn't catch them freaking out. He caught them laughing at the videos.
Yeah, that's what they're kids.
They're kids. And what is it? Yani, as a dad, he can't get angry with them because he shouldn't have those videos in the first place. But how now does he treat the trauma that his kids were just exposed to? Yani, how do you swingle yourself out of it? What do you say to your child?
And the problem is that the kids are going to be exposed to one time or another, but you don't want to be the reason, especially that early on, because.
But Nassim, we're talking about real bad stuff.
Yeah, I know. That's what I'm saying. You don't want to be the reason for them to be stored in their mind. Yeah, because you being a reason means you could potentially get the sins for that, because you were the reason for it. And now that it sticks in their mind, and now they go and research it and look it up, etc. And it could be really.
But what
bad.
Do you say, Yanni? That there's some things I believe in life that you can't go back on, like the third talaq. You're gone. You're finished. Three strikes. You're out. You can't go back on it. That's it. It's done.
Unless they get married. And
you know what I mean? Yeah. All right. There's anything, but that's it. At that point, it's done. No. Right? There's things you can't go back on. You kill someone, you can't go halas. You committed that murder. You've stolen the thing. Yeah, all right. You can rectify the sin, whatever. But the thing is, the action is done, and so therefore, as we know, for the Prophet ﷺ said, is that yes, a Muslim can commit zina. Yes, a Muslim can steal, but he'll face the consequences of those actions. He's still a Muslim, but if he steals, there's consequences. If he lies, there's consequences. There's all these consequences that a Muslim does zina. There's consequences. So if someone's children is exposed to that, how can you rectify that now? How are you going to erase that from their minds? What are you going to do? This is what we say. This is such a sensitive thing. Yani, you would say, I regret the day that I allowed these videos to be watched by myself. Because you know, when you watch them, they end up on your phone.
You have to be very careful regarding that.
Because you can't fix it now. There's no going back. It's not like the kids saw something. You can manipulate their minds to believe that they saw something else. Khalas. They sat there for an hour watching the stuff on your phone. Yeah. What are you going to do?
Before we enter the home stretch or the finish, we enter the final segment of tonight's program. Whoever has any suggestions regarding what we're discussing today, what would you say what not to do during Ramadan, especially during the restrictions? Leave us your feedback on our Facebook page there, Al Bayan Radio, especially those watching on Facebook. Let us know, what would you advise someone not to do? What would you advise your fellow Muslim brothers and sisters what not to do in during these Ramadan restrictions? We'd love to hear from you on our Facebook page there on Al Bayan Radio. Please send your feedback through. Sorry, Sheikh Nassim, tfaddal.
The one point, yani, which is again another flow on from what Dr. Amr is saying, don't let your kids on their devices in their rooms by themselves. This is I know it's a lot sometimes harder to implement sometimes, but if you have the opportunity, and a lot of parents do, if you have the opportunity to not let your children be on their devices in their rooms alone, then make sure you stop them, because wallahi, the take this as a person who a lot of the youth they talk to, and a lot of my classes, you know, that were 13, 14, 15 year old boys, 60 of them, would speak to me about, there's a lot of bad happening, and not only from the boys, wallahi, even the girls. And it'd be very, very, very cautious and wary of what our youth are doing in their bedrooms when they're alone on these devices. A lot of the boys, unfortunately, it's to do a lot more with watching, so they're going on inappropriate websites, and a lot of it comes from the early exposure. They seen something, their friend showed them something, they seen something accidentally on their dad's WhatsApp, and they go searching.
You have to, like, if someone wanted haram on, like, online or whatever, you had to sit there, dig, and go to all these places and fix up whatever. Now it just pops up. Yeah. And now it follows you.
That's how I found out the TikTok videos, because they just jump up on your Facebook feed. But for your sons, especially the younger ones that you still have control over, yani, 11, 12, 13 years old, it's still, there might be some resistance, but it's still pretty easy, generally speaking. But for the daughters, wallahi, and this is scary and upsetting, but a lot of the daughters, they're actually taking videos and photos and sending them to boys. Yani, wallahi, it's very sad, and I know no one likes to talk about it because it's so sensitive and it's a taboo topic, but it's happening in our houses.
Yeah, but the thing is, some parents, yeah, Sheikh Nassim will say, oh, it's the cousin.
No, I'm not talking
about
even.
It's a friend.
I'm not talking about those photos and those videos. That's one side of it. I'm talking about worse. I'm talking about worse than that. And again, now obviously they're at home. Their whole life is on social media. Their friends on social media. The classmates on social media. The boys, the girls, everyone. As parents, we just need to be more cautious, more wary. We need to be more educated. We need to speak to our children about the dangers. Yani, this is all extremely important because, wallahi, in these times, yani, with the restrictions, it's increasing.
Get the children,
it's increasing,
off the devices. But to underline, asterisk, footnote, monkey see, monkey do.
Words of wisdom from Dr. Amr Atim. We got some comments here. Our dear brother Muhammad Khadr, part of the team here at Bayan Radio. Hay Allah, Shabab.
حياكم الله.
بارك الله فيك. Our
Greeny.
Yeah, our local Greeny. Muhammad Khadr, one of the voices of Al Bayan Radio.
He's our fourth man, bro.
Yes. He was on last week.
He was one of the OGs.
Very beneficial program you gave last week. Inshallah, you're back with us. Also, some advice from brother Ghazi. He says, don't waste the precious time. What not to do? Don't waste time. That's pretty much everything we've mentioned in one word, basically. Don't waste time.
And even any fun, fun can be had.
In a few words, sorry.
Even fun can be had with the right intention. You get rewarded for it. That little bit of sleep extra that you have, that little bit of entertainment that you have, halal, you can get rewarded that right intention, it's and alhamdulillah, it's beautiful. But don't make it, you know, don't make the fun and the games the majority of your time and the majority of your life.
I just want to ask Dr. Omar if you heard what Mr. President Trump said about what will help get rid of the coronavirus.
Because it's from China.
What did he say? Did you hear it? Inject yourself with the disinfectant, the detergent?
Something, I heard something he was saying that, what do you think detergent, about that? But it doesn't, and you have to, I don't know what has gone on about something. I wasn't paying attention about it.
I wanted to get your thoughts since you're in the medical profession.
Did he actually say inject yourself with detergent?
Some.
It was a joke.
Was it a joke or he was serious?
No, it wasn't serious.
He wasn't serious?
No, it wasn't serious.
Because you know what it is? He'll say something
that a normal president wouldn't, and people
will take it serious. And like he said, we're testing this medication, hydrochlor something. I can't remember what it was called.
I'm getting to a point. That's why I mentioned it.
Anyway, he was just mentioning that we might start. So these people went and they started getting this chemical and they started drinking it and they died.
That's what I'm saying. What I'm getting at is a point here regarding what we're going through is don't use anything that is not medically proven by proper doctors, people of knowledge, especially God-fearing Muslim doctors.
Talk about jokes being taken seriously. I got asked, and this is wallah, no joke, and the guy was 100% serious. He said, I got a message, and if it wasn't from him, I'll think it was a joke. Because I got a message saying that we only fast 7 days of Ramadan this year and we delay 22 days to next month. And he goes, is this true?
Why?
What's his reasoning?
No, he believed that someone said it as a joke. Someone just sent it as a joke. Yeah, and he hacked on one of his groups. And subhanAllah, he actually took it seriously. So be very careful. There are people that, even though it's a clear joke, that takes it very carefully.
But about misinformation, just correct information, just so everyone can understand where you're at, not just with coronavirus, with a lot of viruses, yeah? Especially viruses that affect the lungs. Understand, like, the important thing is whatever you hear, most of the time is incorrect about do this and do that and do this and try that. This medication and this old medication we used to take, you know, can cure it or whatever. Hello, we know the remedies of the Quran and Habit al-Barakah and Asal and all these things. 100%. Yes, they are a cure for all diseases by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're talking about the medical world. So people, and we know, Yani mentioned this sometimes to people, they get confused and say, you know what, I never looked at it like that. The problem is that this disease, this virus, infects the lungs, right? And between the lungs, there's a barrier between the lungs and the bloodstream. And the problem is that even if you had a vaccine that can kill the virus, the challenge is to get it from the bloodstream to actually enter the lungs and to treat it because there's a membrane, there's a barrier. So even the scientists and the medical professionals saying, even if we had a vaccine, that's not the challenge. Like for one disease, and one brother, Pakistani brother, he was doing his PhD in Macquarie University on this topic. There's one bacteria that has no cure. They call it golden staph. I don't know if you've heard about it before. Every time you have an operation or whatever, they tell you one disease that you can catch that we cannot cure it. We've got no antibiotics for it. Is what they call. They call it golden staph. They give it the name golden staph, right? Or staph aureus is another name for it. There's only one thing, subhanAllah, that can cure it, and it's honey.
Oh, Akbar.
That's the only thing. Research it. Type it in, golden staph and honey. You'll find research on it. Honey stops the growth of it. But that's not the problem. The cure is there. But you can't inject honey in someone's bloodstream.
Mm.
So he was trying to find out what's the active ingredient in honey and how that could be injected and become a portal to be able to fight that disease. But it's a long way to have something and to be able to inject it. This is the challenge. And this is what he was doing his PhD on. So just understand that sometimes, you talk about cure, but it's how to get the cure to the place where it should be. And when you're talking about lungs, you talk to the medical professionals, it's a whole different thing altogether. Because unfortunately, there are people, yeah, they, as soon as they get, oh, they found the cure and they're sending all these remedies. And some of the remedies, some of the things can actually harm a person. And in saying that, I met someone, he's exporting, his business is shot through the roof. Natural remedies. Where's he exporting? Exporting his natural remedies to? To Iran. He's found a massive market. Why? Because herbal. And a lot of things they're buying, they're making their own mix, thinking that it would cure the, for example, coronavirus or whatever. At the end of the day, know that this virus can go away, and it's gone away with the majority of people. How are you, Steznado? How's it gone away? Without treatment.
Without treatment.
No treatment at all.
All from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So yeah, that proves that there is a cure. The cure is the human body. From the permission of Allah, the body is able to cure itself from this actual virus. Illa man rahim Allah.
What they want to do is make a vaccine and inject us all with it. And then
we don't want to spend too much time on it, because I know some brothers and sisters that listen to us to get a bit of a release from all the outside news, because you know it can become overwhelming wherever you go, whatever you see, whoever you talk to is talking about the same thing. I'm not saying don't be informed, but at the same time, we don't want to be misinformed, and at the same time over-informed on certain things where we need just to know what will get us by and enough to function daily as Muslims. Now, moving on, what else do we have before we conclude tonight, Sheikh Nasim? Any final words regarding this topic? We know we can mention many, many things. Just anything else? Don't overeat.
Don't binge.
Don't binge.
You know what? Khalas, you mentioned it. You know, a lot of people, they struggle to pray, even when, subhanAllah, we were blessed with the mashayikh in Taraweeh. A lot of the people struggle to pray Taraweeh properly because they're half asleep because they're in a coma. You know, they're in their food coma. If one of the keys to actually praying Taraweeh nice and easily is to not overeat at iftar. So if you're praying at home and you want to pray and you want to make your life easy, don't overeat.
You know, I'll give you a suggestion. Dr. Omar knows this because I've discussed it with him before. Is have a light iftar. Have a light iftar. Even have some dates, some water, a soup if you like. Go pray your Maghrib prayer. Come back, have something small. And do what you got to do. Pray your Isha and Tarweeh. And then have something a bit more heavier. And then have Suhoor, you know, before Fajr as normal. And wallahi, you feel a lot better. But to overeat, and as we say, stuff yourself at Maghrib, you can barely move to even. And if you haven't prayed Maghrib, you find it hard to pray Maghrib then. So what about...
Don't delay Maghrib. That's, I should mention that from the beginning. Don't delay Maghrib.
The thing too is, for those that ask about Salah, no, you can't pray behind the virtual imam.
Are you serious?
I'm serious. I remember they asked one of the ulama, I can't remember exactly, they said, can you pray behind the like, if the haram, so, or whatever. There's a sheikh on live TV, can you pray Salat al-Jum'ah behind him or Taraweeh behind him? The sheikh said, yes, you can. He said, if the TV can make sujood and ruku', I guess then you can, as a joke to them.
Now, another one, you know what he said as well? He said, you might as well put a blanket over the fridge and do tawaf around it as well.
Well, I used to think that, you know, I know that it was asked, but I think, khalas, there were jokes and no one thinks about it anymore. But when this coronavirus...
Some happened, are genuine questions. They're not joking.
Yeah. I know, that's the problem. Mm. When the coronavirus hit, some of the questions that were being asked, wallahi, I was so shocked, and it was very upsetting, actually.
From one angle, it is sad, and another angle, it's good that they're asking.
It's good that they're asking. Yeah. That's always a positive. But it's so sad that there's so much Islamic information available. And this is part of the, subhanAllah, when a person studies the signs of the Day of Judgment, you find that there's things that seem to be opposites. That, for example, the Prophet said the pen will be widespread, and knowledge will be widespread, but ignorance will also be widespread. And subhanAllah, how they're meant to be, it's meant to be like two opposites, like it's like oxymoron. Like they're two opposites, but you know, knowledge and ignorance being widespread. How does that happen? But subhanAllah, look at our reality. Look at how many books, look at how many lessons, look at how many mashayikh, look at how many everything, and basic things like this, we don't know. Coronavirus really, opened up my eyes to a lot of unfortunate things, subhanAllah.
With the virtual, obviously you can't pray behind the virtual imam or the radio or TV or whatever it may be. You can, a lot of people saying, how do I pray Taraweeh? Pray to what you know. And a lot of people say, but my Taraweeh won't be that long. Yeah, it can be. Because you can prolong the ruku' and you can prolong the sujood also.
And you can make dua, and you can hold the mushaf and read.
Pray with what you got. Pray with what you got.
I done a yesterday a lesson on Facebook about a lot of commonly asked questions about Tarawih. So if there are people who have a lot of questions, they can go on the
Facebook. We'll share it after we conclude, inshallah. 13, 14, 15-year-old children, mashallah, they've memorized the few juz from the Quran. Let them lead the salah. Encourage them.
So don't be lazy in your prayer, in other words.
You know what
pray.
I mean?
Pray what you know.
Encourage them to pray. You pray behind them. That's a form of encouragement to them. Yalla, ibni, tafaddal.
Sheikh Muhammad Dua mentioned last night on our first episode of Ramadan Nights, Jazahullah Khair, he mentioned the hadith of the companion who used to always repeat Surah Al-Ikhlas in his salah whenever he used to lead the people, the companions in prayer. And they went to the Prophet ﷺ and asked him. And he mentioned that he loves to recite it. So, and he was informed, tell him that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves him. And there's another similar report that I love to recite it because it describes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he used to repeat it.
So
why not? It's perfectly permissible to recite one surah after Surah Al-Fatiha in each rak'ah. It's permissible. Now, can you read more? Yes, as our ulama have said. But that suffices. So do not miss out on this great sunnah in Ramadan. So pray your Isha prayer. Then pray 10 rak'ah, 2 by 2 by 2, and then finish it off with witr. One or three.
They have a connection to a certain surah.
No problem.
Go for it. Some people, this might be a weird one, it's in a way, but one person was asked, why you always read, Watini wa Zaytun? He said, because I had a grandfather that used to do a lot of planting and things like that. And Otin and Zaytun, he used to plant all the, and he's the one that taught me Quran, he's the one that taught me Hadith, he's the one that taught me, he goes, and when he taught me that surah, he'll tell me the way to memorize. He goes, think about my teen and Zaytun that I grow in the, in the backyard, as a sort of like encouragement for him to remember. He said, that just let me build this emotional that almost every Isha prayer or Fajr, he goes, I have to read that surah. So yeah, read the surah that you love, the surah that reminds you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reminds you of ilm. And wallah, I don't expect you to read Surah Al-Baqarah in your home. But no, we don't. Pray what you know. Or as we said before, you can pray with the mushaf in front of you. And at the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what you're capable of. What you're capable of. But if you, mashallah, memorize the whole Quran, and you barely make any mistakes or whatever, obviously you're encouraged to read that which you know, because that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, the one that that recites the Quran, that reads the Quran. So I think what not to do in Ramadan is not to be shy in front of your family. Don't think, I'm going to embarrass myself. My kids are going to look down on me if I make a mistake. Or at the end of the day, you read what you know. And you are the man, or you're supposed to be the man of the house. So you're supposed to lead the people in salah. Not like questions that we get, can my wife lead the salah if she knows more Quran than me? You are the man of the house. And regardless, the nature of any wife is that she wants a man of the house. We hope so. That the nature of the wife is she wants a leader of the house. The children, they want to see the imam, as we say, Khalifa al-Bayt, the Khalifa or the caretaker of the house. We want them to lead the salah. So other than that, I think from me, Jazakumullah khair, I'm done.
Well, you've concluded the program for us. Jazakumullah khair.
I've had my input. I think if I have any more, I'll just keep going, subhanAllah, because there's a lot of stuff you can get into on this topic.
Barakallahu feek, Dr. Amar. Sheikh Nasim, any final words since Amar wrapped up the program?
Jazakumullah khair. You said hello like that. How do you say goodbye?
Same thing, yeah.
It's a very, it's a flick.
Flick like that?
No. It's a flick.
Not a rotation?
No, a flick. Flick. No, not your whole arm, just your wrist. Flick of the wrist.
But you have two fingers.
You'll get there. We'll teach you off air, inshallah.
There's a bit of practice.
Jazakallah khair, Dr. Omar. Jazakallah khair, Sheikh Nasim. I'd like to thank all our viewers who watched on Facebook and all our brothers and sisters who listened through the Wi-Fi radio and our apps. Just another reminder that whoever hasn't...
Nasim.
Jazakallah khair.
He's got...
Yes.
He's got one finger. You got two fingers.
Yes. Thanks for ruining my announcement, but that's all right. It's become a norm. I'm going to ruin the outro of programs or the beginning.
Today's done double whammy.
Yes, the our app on the Apple Store has been updated, so please update your app to have a more reliable app, better service, inshallah. And the Android is coming, so please pay attention to your app on the Google Play Store as well. And for those who have the TuneIn, they can listen in their cars, on their devices, on their PC, wherever they may be. Just type in Albayan Radio. I'd like to thank everyone for tuning in, and Sheikh Nasim and Dr. Omar one more time. And until next time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Albayan Radio, the voice of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah.